Bishop, we thank you. Mama, we thank you. Everybody who is here is happy. Nobody is angry. Nobody is planning to go away even after the meeting is over. You are going to struggle to push them out. This is how hospitable you are in this place. And so you make everybody and everything to feel at home, because God is in this place. Because the man of God has really plowed through a number of very key things, and we want to make sure that by midnight we are on our feet. Hallelujah. Yeah, one, just make sure you can't cross seated. You cross standing. The only thing that you may do besides standing is to fly. Hallelujah. And we thank God also, as we have said before, for all the generals that have stood on this pulpit throughout, from the 24th to this afternoon up to this evening, holding the hands of Bishop and Mama. And so we thank God for you, most of whom I've met for the first time also in my life, and they've become my friends whether they like it or not. Praise the Lord. Because they are good people. Hallelujah. Dr. Nevas Mumba, we recognize him as His Excellency Dr. Nevas Mumba. In diplomatic protocol, ambassadors are known as His Excellency. And then in some countries, vice presidents are called the Honorable. And then in some countries, they're also known as His Excellency. So we value that. Those are lifetime endowments. They don't go away. It's like in the army. Once a general, you are a general forever. You may retire, but you are still known as General so-and-so retired. Colonel so-and-so retired. Brigadier so-and-so retired. It's like the anointing in the church. Yeah. Even if you become businessman, a sailor, you are still Bishop so-and-so who is in that other work. So we appreciate the word that he brought to the house. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now in the book of Genesis in chapter 6, I'll read just very few verses, and I want to keep my watch close to me. In Genesis chapter 6, Genesis, the 6th chapter, we're going to read that, and we'll read it together with Numbers chapter 22. Now in chapter 6 of Genesis, verse 5 up to 8, it says, "And the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it grieved the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it pained him at heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing, and the birds of the air, for it grieves me that I have made them. But Noah found grace. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Hallelujah. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And then in the book of Numbers, chapter 22, verse 41, it says, and it happened on the following day that Balak took Balaam and brought him up into the high places of Baal so that he might see the uttermost parts of the people. Balak took Balaam, brought him to the high places of Baal, so that from there he might see the uttermost parts of the people. And then chapter 23, verse 1 says, and Balaam said to Balak, build for me here 7 altars, and prepare 7 oxen and 7 rams for me here. And Balak did as Balaam had spoken. Also Balak and Balaam offered on every altar a bull and a ram. And Balaam said to Balak, stand by your burnt offering, and I'll go. Perhaps the Lord will come to meet me, and whatever he shows me, I will tell you. And he went to a high place. And God met Balaam, and he said to him, And Balaam said to God, I have prepared 7 altars, and I have offered upon every altar a bull and a ram. And the Lord put a word in Balaam's mouth and said, return to Balak, and you shall speak this. And then he returned to him, and there he stood by the burnt sacrifice, he and all the princes of Moab. And he took up a parable. He took up a parable. He took up a parable. And when he took up that parable, on verse 7, he took up his parable and said, Balak, the king of Moab, has brought me from Aram out of the mountains of the east, saying, come and curse for me Jacob, and come and denounce Israel. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. And then we'll finish off with Psalms chapter 20 on verse 1, where it says, the Lord hear you in the day of trouble. The name of the God of Jacob defend you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May he remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice. May he grant you according to your own heart and fulfill all your counsel. We will rejoice in your salvation. And in the name of our God, we will set up our banners. The Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will hear him from his holy heaven with the saving strength of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Amen. They are brought down and fallen, but we have risen and we stand upright. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. There are many things that govern the movements of people. There are many things that govern the movements of people. About 4 days ago, in Harare, Zimbabwe, one of the assistant commissioners of police was driving a car just outside of the city center. And then there were trees on the side of the road. You know, trees that have just existed there for hundreds of years and so forth. So one of the trees just came down and it fell on the roof of his vehicle and then crushed him and then he died. And this was an assistant commissioner of police. He was buried yesterday. I saw it, you know, in the newspapers today. And so when I was watching the news and the news was talking about the death of this assistant, you know, commissioner of police, that he was driving and then the tree left its place and the tree came into his place. The tree came into the road and fell. It did not come down ahead of his car or after his car, but it came when his car was coming. And so it fell on the roof of his car. And then, now the vehicle is normally longer than just where your head is located when you are driving. So, but the tree did not miss his head. It missed the seats. It missed the wheels. It missed everything, but it did not miss his head. And then just crushed him like that. So when we were watching the news, I was sitting, you know, together with one bishop and his wife, and we were just watching the news. And so when the news, you know, announced that, this bishop spoke back and said, "This is not just normal." You understand it? This is not just normal. Now, you are not going to cross 2015 to 2016 in a normal way. Because the things that you see in Soweto, in South Africa, are not just normal. Now, when you find God acting the way that he did, I thank God that he led my predecessor, the previous speaker, exactly on the same story of Noah to start with. Now, whereby there were things that were happening in that generation that were not normal. That were not normal. And God uses the word in English, he says, the world was corrupt. Yeah. Now, you know, what we call corruption today is not the actual corruption. What we call corruption, it's introduction to corruption. Real corruption is existing in the unseen world. Now, what God called corruption in the days of Noah was not just about those people who divert your money or steal your money from your pocket or change figures on a piece of paper, but people that God called corrupt and he destroyed the world and gave grace to Noah. Those that he called corrupt were people who had movements for changing God's order on earth. Hey. To completely eliminate the order of God. Yeah. And set a new world order.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
to completely blot out and eliminate God's order and make sure that there is no memory of God. We don't just need God, according to them. They just did not need God. They did not want even to remember him. They did not want him in their records. Now, to eliminate God from the schools, it's corruption. To eliminate God from the constitution of a country, it's corruption. To eliminate God from the constitution of a company or business, it's corruption. To eliminate God from being heard publicly, in public places, to say, you can talk about anything in public except God. You can talk about even pornography in public minus God. You can talk about thefts and robbery. You can talk about evolution. You can talk about science and technology, but don't mention God in public. God called that corruption. Now, that was happening not because the situation was normal. Abnormality was coming into the earth. Now, let me tell you this. Sometimes in Genesis chapter 1, you hear God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Male and female, then he made them. Then he blessed them. Now, the deterioration that has come upon your life, the decline which has come upon your life, it's corruption. When God looks at how you have fallen from the level of blessedness which he established at the beginning, when he looks at whatsoever has caused that, he calls it corruption. Now, the commissions, the anti-corruption commissions, are not addressing what I'm talking about. They are addressing very small things. They are addressing very small things. But I want you to understand another world which is engaged. Right now, as we are stepping into closing a year, beginning a year, there are also other worlds and other kingdoms with corrupt plans for 2016. And one of them, we have just read about it here. One of them, we read of a wicked partnership. Tell your neighbor and say, wicked partnership. Wicked partnerships. Now, a king called Balak hired a wicked priest called Balaam from a faraway country from the east, and brought him and he said, can you please come? Because I have seen a people who are still keeping God in their culture. I have seen a people who are still honoring another God called Jehovah. I am hiring you. I'll pay you whatever needs to be paid. I'll pay you to curse them. Right, you understand this?
Yes,
I'll pay you to curse them. In other words, this guy was hired to curse a whole country, to curse all of Israelites. You know what he did? Says he went on a high place. On a what?
High
place. Now, I want to tell you something. Time does not Okay, we'll deal with some of the issues after crossing over,
yeah,
during the declarations.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, sir.
But I want to train your eyes to be very sensitive and your spirit to be very discerning.
Yeah.
Now, the guy was hired and went to stand on a high place, which means Israel was in a valley. Israel was in a lower place. This guy went in a higher place. And then he stood there. Firstly, before he cursed them, before he plotted to curse them, he was to see the extent of the people, to see how far the people are going. There is something that is called demonic surveillance, demonic observation, demonic monitoring of how far we are going, how far you are planning. Now, I thank God, because the other night I listened to Bishop Mutua from Kenya when he was talking about people who talk too much. Now, of course, he was talking about the dangers of talking too much when you are a girl who wants to get married, or a young man who wants to get married. But I want to also say, don't talk too much. Don't talk too much. Also, when you don't know who is listening. Because now, there are some corrupt people who specialize. Now, why am I talking these things? Because the man of God has spoken. And indeed, we are crossing over. But there will be, after every year, year after year, there are some casualties starting from the month of January after crossing over. There are some wounded ones in February. There are others who begin to lose everything in March because they don't know how to retain, how to keep on, and how to preserve the gains after crossing over. Now, let me tell you, there are corrupt people out there in the world of the spirit who specialize in watching how far you are planning to go, who specialize in watching and just observing how far you want to go. How far you want to go. Now, so he stood there. Then he saw how far they were, how many they were. Then began to raise altars. Says raise seven altars. Now, seven is a number of completeness,
yeah,
a number of fullness. So he says seven altars. Now, after building seven altars, he said also, on each altar we are going to sacrifice a bull and a ram. Now, those who work in the meat industry, they know how much one bull costs. Now, Balak was supplying the bulls and supplying the rams. Now, seven bulls. One bull, if we are, you know, just talking small figures, one bull can mean 10,000 rands. 10,000 times seven, 70,000 rands was put into offerings and the sacrifices to curse God's people. Are you seeing the level of corruption?
Yeah.
70,000 rands are put into that, plus also seven rams. So that, because they know, among the people of God, let me tell you about witchcraft. Now, witchcraft does not work. In fact, witchcraft cannot be used by a person who does not have some divine knowledge. Because witchcraft, it's actually stolen divine knowledge. which is being misused. This is why even a church is dangerous to pray for a situation you don't understand. You become a witch. In the prayer meeting, you become a witch in the prayer meeting. Sometimes so many prayers are offered out of ignorance and they become corruption. Because in the Bible, in Israel, when a situation went bad and people did not understand, they would ask the Lord. The first prayer was to ask the Lord, why is there no rain? Why is there no rain? Now, if you were a believer in the days of Noah and you did not have divine knowledge of what he is doing, if you saw the floods, you would organize a prayer meeting to bind the floods. Lord, I bind these floods in the name of Jesus. I stop these rains. But God is releasing the floods.